This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you to Jeff McConaughey, for our guest organist, for welcoming us to worship with that beautiful, beautiful piece. Let us pray. Lord, we come to this hour expecting you to fill us with your Spirit. May we open ourselves to this movement, that when we leave, we will be transformed, that going out into the world, we'd be signs of your love. Amen. Let us rise in body or in spirit for the call to worship. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill the heart. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill the hearts of your faithful. Light our hearts on fire with your love. Send forth your Spirit, and we shall be recreated. Renew the face of the earth. Amen. Let us remain standing as we join together in our opening hymn, Holy, 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 on page 64.
Please be seated. Our Hebrew Bible lesson comes from Genesis, chapter 11, verses 1 through 9. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as they migrated from the east, they came upon a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we shall be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which mortals had built. And the Lord said, "Look, they are one people, and they have all one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. Nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language there, so that they will not understand one another's speech." So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth. The word of God for the people of God. Amen.
To the Father's heart. I'd like to invite the children to come forward. If we have anyone. I think we got a couple running this way. Guys. So I'm not sure, I'm not going to put you guys on the spot because I know it's scary to be up here kind of by yourself. But earlier today in the sanctuary, I'm not sure if you saw, but there was a bird that got into the sanctuary. Did you see this? It was a bird. It was floating around here, and I think Kelvin was somehow related to this bird or somehow connected to this bird. And the bird hung around for a little while, and I think a few people might have got thwacked by the bird as the bird flew around the sanctuary. And I saw birds outside today, too. And in fact, if you look at this cross I have here, do you see that? That's a dove. Yeah, it's a dove. It's a bird. You know, in our Bible, we have this story about when Jesus was baptized, that something like a bird came down upon him. We hear this story told that the Spirit of God, that the Holy Spirit, is like a dove. Now, it's important to know that when we say like a dove, do you guys know what a simile is yet? Maybe, maybe not. No, might be. When we say that the Spirit is like a dove, we're not saying that God is a bird. We're saying that that is a word that can help us best understand some aspect of who God is. When I think of birds, I think of things that are hard to control. Like birds are flying around, they're hard to catch. I'm not sure if you've ever chased after a bird to try and catch a bird, but they're really hard to catch.
Ooh. We have two bird feeders in our backyard.
You have two bird feeders in your backyard, so you get to watch birds, and their wings are very quick, and they move around pretty quickly. And I think this might be telling us something about God, particularly about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is hard to capture. The Holy Spirit flies around and doesn't pay attention to what we want the Holy Spirit to do, but what the Holy Spirit wants to do. So the Holy Spirit is like a bird in that it is fluttering and flying and hard to find and hard to capture. Will you guys pray with me? Oh, you have a question or a thought?
Yeah, I saw a dead bird when I was in kindergarten.
Oh, no.
I took a walk around the school and there was a
There was someone saw a dead bird in kindergarten. That is what is being shared. Well, let's pray. This is a repeat after me prayer, okay? Dear God,
thank you
for sending us your Spirit.
Help us
to see your Spirit,
moving in the world.
Amen.
Amen.
Audrey, do we have children's church today? We have children's church today if you want to go with Audrey, if you're interested.
As a community of faith, we will always be in prayer with and for one another. I draw your attention to the bulletin insert that has a couple prayer concerns. listed in there so that you can hold these folks, the members of your community, within your prayers. If you have prayer concerns that you'd like the pastors to be aware of, you should have little cards in the pew back pockets in front of you. You can write on those and fold them up and stick them in the offering plate after worship today. We come today carrying many things in our hearts and minds, some of which we've shared with each other and some we hold within ourselves. As we enter into our time of prayer, we'll begin with a moment of silence, and that'll lead us in a corporate prayer. Let us pray. Jesus, you told us that you would not leave us alone. You told us that the world won't see you, but we will. But, Brother Jesus, we confess that we have trouble seeing you. We fail to recognize your face in the faces of those made refugees by climate disaster. Sometimes we fail to see your face in the face of our neighbor standing at the stoplight. Sometimes we become apathetic and fail to see your face in the faces of those impacted by violence and disaster. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon us. Yet you do not leave us alone. You have sent your Spirit upon us. We are gathered in this time, in this place, hoping that once again the Spirit would empower us. Inspirit us, fill us with your Spirit. Heal us of our failure to perceive. Soften our hearts that we might love like you love. Sharpen our minds that we may speak as you would have us speak, and strengthen our resolve so that we might act as you would have us act. We, your people, come before you imperfect, but going on to perfection. We lift up to you today those we carry in our hearts and minds. In the silence of these moments, we pray for those who are grieving. We pray for those facing illness. We pray for those sitting in despair. We pray for those who call the outdoors their home. We pray for those who have lost their way. Form us and shape us, dear Lord, so that we might be the answer to another's prayer. We pray all this in your name. Amen. Let us join together in the prayer response found in your bulletin.
Announcements this week. Want to let you know that annual conference is now over. I'm not sure why we don't do it online all the time. It goes a lot faster with less shenanigan. But next Sunday after church, after this hour, we're going to have what we're calling the scoop. We're going to have ice cream, yes, ice cream before lunch. and give you an update on annual conference and some of the buzz that is about in terms of the life of our denomination. Mind you, there has nothing been decided, but you might have some interest or curiosity in what the buzz is. So join us at the Scoop. Also, next week, on the 11th, is the Pride Festival at Bethel International Church from 10 until 12. And then the next weekend is the Pride Parade. We are taking the bus, and if you would like to ride and have a way to get down and get back without worrying about parking, just let us know, and we'll make sure you get a ride. One of the great things about this church is its people and the gift that you are. And I want you to know today just how blessed Dom and I feel to be serving in this place, to know you and to know your spirits, your commitment, your desire to be faithful. On this day, hear our blessing because of you and our thank you. If you would, now let's prepare to receive our offering in any way you choose to offer it.
Thank you.
Would you join me in our offertory prayer? God of wind, word, and fire, we bless your name this day for sending the light and strength of your Holy Spirit. We give you thanks for all the gifts, great and small, that you have poured out upon your children. Accept us with our gifts to be living praise and witness to your love throughout all the earth. Through Jesus Christ, who lives with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our lesson this morning is found in Acts chapter 2 and is the traditional text for Pentecost Sunday. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we heard them speak about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea, all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days, I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Amen. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Sing, God, a simple song. God, a lie.
Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength, our rock, our love, and our Redeemer. Amen. I am confused most of the time. In this regard, I relate to the folks and the story of the Tower of Babel. I am confused most of the time, and I thought this would be something that went away as I got older or studied more or had more experiences, but if anything, I am more confused now than I've ever been. Part of this is my problem. The universe is big, and I am small, relatively speaking, and there are going to be things that I can't accommodate into my framework of understanding. I will never know every fact of history. I won't understand the mechanics of physics, and I refuse to. I can never experience everything that you all have experienced, let alone folks who live on the other side of the world. Part of this confusion is that I am finite and the world is huge, but some of my confusion isn't my problem alone, and maybe you are confused as well. Some of it is the result of the general absurdity that surrounds us. The world is chaotic, and a normal response to chaos is confusion. On the most superficial level, culture is changing rapidly, and it's hard to keep pace. I'm on the younger end of the millennial generation, and I have trouble making sense of the signs and symbols and signifiers of Gen Z. But this confusion is deeper than a simple generational divide. The recent storms of gun violence is grotesque and reflects a deep and unintelligible idolatry that shapes our public policy and infects our relationships. How do we make sense of this. COVID revealed that our bodies are vulnerable and that our social institutions are more fragile than we thought. How do we make sense of this? Instead of politics that care for the material, mental, cultural, and spiritual well-being of our neighbors, we find ourselves in enmeshed, in polarizing and empty culture wars that pit us in a war of slogans, while the poor and marginalized continue to suffer. How do we make sense of this? We're told, and we occasionally accept, that there is nothing to be done about poverty or gun violence or racism or violence or environmental disaster or any other of the myriad issues that surround us. Of course, we're confused. Our worldview has been broken again and again over the last few years, and it makes sense to be confused because as Christians, we can see that there is a canyon between the world as God would have it and the world as it is. I'm going to start with the bad news, and I hope that by the end of our time together, it will become good news. The bad news is that our reading today, the story of Pentecost, the story of the birth of our church, does not offer any order to the chaos and confusion. If anything, our text today tells the story of confusion, of gushing languages and manic testimonies and power that can't be comprehended nor controlled. No wonder the witnesses to these things were amazed and perplexed. It is amazing. It is perplexing. We forget sometimes that the Holy Spirit is a living thing. Sometimes we treat her as a theological convenience or an intellectual hurdle, but the Holy Spirit cannot be controlled or contained. The Spirit is living, uncontrollable, relational, bound up in our lives, but outside of us, yet filling us, different from who we are and distinct from the world, yet enlivening us, one, yet in perfect community within God's self. What I'm trying to say is, behind all that language, is that the Holy Spirit is a gift and it doesn't fit the boxes we build for it. The story of Pentecost, at least from a human perspective, is a story of chaos. As Reverend Isaac Villegas notes, if the purpose of Pentecost was only for people to understand each other, the Spirit would have given the gift to speak only in Latin and Greek. It would have been the most efficient. Everyone there would know how to either speak Latin, the language of the courts, or Greek, the language of every day and the market. They would have understood each other if the Spirit gave the gift of Latin and Greek. But instead, the disciples speak in the native languages of those who surround them. Villegas interprets this to mean that in the church, by the power of the Spirit, we bring all of our particularities and experiences and uniqueness into the life of the church. The church does not demand that people surrender their backgrounds in order to be brought into community, nor does it demand they surrender their identities to be brought into community. The Spirit does not create a universal language or a centralized hegemonizing culture. I shouldn't use a word if I can't pronounce it. Rather, the community of the Spirit is multilingual, multicultural, reveling in diversity of body and experience. Put simply, the church isn't monotone. It's a mosaic. The community is not formed in the palace or the temple, and the Spirit isn't poured out upon the scribes and scholars and priests, but on the fishers and carpenters and wanderers from Galilee. The Holy Spirit doesn't create uniformity, nor does it eliminate cultural difference, nor does it pour out where people expect. The Spirit revels in rainbows, in symphony, in confusion, and impossibility. What does the outpouring of the Spirit do? What does this mean? That's what those who were amazed and perplexed asked. What does this mean? Peter interprets this for those who gather. Peter tells those gathered that the Spirit is breaking through the borders and the boundaries and the binaries that they have built to control God. The prophet Joel speaks about how God will give the gift of the Spirit not just to the royal house of David and those anointed as prophets, but to all of Israel. Peter places his hands on Joel's words and stretches them beyond even this. Not only men will speak on God's behalf, but people of all genders. Not only those who are free will prophesy, but those who have been enslaved and oppressed. Not only those who are young will have dreams, but those who are older will as well. And not only those who are older will speak with authority, but those who are young will as well. The Spirit falls upon the disciples, and later in the Acts text, we read that day by day the Lord added to their number. They shared with one another, each according to their need, and they broke bread together. Through the Spirit, God is calling together a community that will be the church, the body of Christ, responding to the will of the Creator, empowered by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit calls the faithful to recognize that the good news of Jesus Christ is not just for the individual, but for the community. That the kingdom of God is not just a promise for life after death, but something that is revealed and lived together now as well. Church, allow me to testify. I'm speaking for myself now, interpreting Acts in light of my own life. As a young pastor, I have often felt that I was late to the party. I'm a pastor in a denomination that has been in the process of splitting for just about as long as it's been together. Religion holds a smaller and smaller place in the lives of a growing number of people in the U.S., and of course, this makes me a little bit anxious. And particularly in the last 8 years or so, I have felt that the church, and by this I mean the whole church, the big C church, has had very little meaningful to say about matters of justice and compassion in a manner that incarnates the body of Christ in the world. The church is meant to be filled with the Spirit, but we instead act as a barometer for the spirit of the age, disembodied, superficial, safe, sanitized, spiritual, but not faithful. In my more cynical moments, when I'm burnt out or disappointed with myself, I feel foolish for tying my life so closely to the life of this institution. Yet I believe this. God is not yet done with the church. God is not yet done with the church. Let me say it one more time. God is not yet done with the church. On occasion, we lose the thread speaking in Latin or Greek when we should be speaking in Persian or Parthian. Looking for the Spirit in the temple when we should be looking in the alleyways, expecting only the well-educated and well-off to prophesy. And God is not yet done with the church. Every year we celebrate Pentecost not just to remember something that happened 2,000 years ago, but to adopt a posture of hope that it might happen again. Renew us, dear Spirit. Light us on fire, Holy One. But I have a warning. Don't miss this sign. Don't skip this part of the text. If we open ourselves up to the movement of the Spirit, we don't know where this journey will end. And I can assure you that we will not escape chaos and confusion. The first chapter of Genesis tells us that before creation, the Spirit of God, the Ruach Elohim, hovered over the face of the deep chaos. The Spirit is older and deeper and richer than the chaos and confusion of our lives. But that doesn't mean that everyone will get it if we catch on fire with the Spirit. When we follow the Spirit, people will talk. They'll wonder about that church at 600 High Street. Are they drunk? Can't be. They're Methodist. Can't be. They gather at 10 o'clock in the morning. Are we prepared for the Spirit to move us out of our sanctuary? Are we ready for the Spirit to speak from those among us who haven't served on committees? Are we ready for our youth to preach the gospel? For languages to fill our sanctuary from other parts of the world? Are we ready to let go of the structures and rituals that have sustained us through the chaos so far but no longer serve us? Let's begin here. And I'll let you know, I sent an email to Lou talking about this part of the sermon, so don't think I'm springing this on her. You do not need permission from Lou or from me to do ministry. And you don't need us to lead it for it to happen. Lou and I, as elders in the United Methodist Church, are called to four things: to preach the gospel, administer the sacraments, serve you and the world, and give a little order to the life of the church. You do not need our permission to launch a new mercy and justice ministry with our unhoused neighbors. You don't need our blessing to start a small group for you and your friends and neighbors. You don't need our go-ahead to retool a ministry that could use a little retooling. You don't need us to lead every book club or Bible study for it to happen. If you feel called to it, try it. If you want support and resources, ask us. If you need a space in the church, talk to Dennis. And if it doesn't work, be encouraged, because every experiment helps us refine our understanding and guide our discernment of where the Spirit is calling us as a worshiping community. Lou and I cannot restrain this church if we tried, and we do not want to try. We will be a church that leaks the Spirit out of our pores, that reveals the love of God to those for whom love is a stranger, that stands alongside those who are forgotten and pushed aside. Are you amazed and perplexed? I hope so. My prayer is that we would be amazed and perplexed. I offer you no antidote to the confusion and chaos of life, my friends, but I can offer you this. By the power of the Spirit, the chaos and confusion is transfigured into something deep and beautiful and life-giving. The Holy Spirit changes everything. This gift of God changes everything. It changes how we see our friends and strangers and enemies. It shapes our ethics and our politics. It changes how we drive and how we grocery shop and who we see and what we care about. It changes how we love ourselves and our communities. The Holy Spirit even changes how we eat. When the disciples experienced the outpouring of the Spirit, thousands came to watch them burn with God's gift. They gathered these thousands into small groups, and together they broke bread and shared a drink in the name of Christ. In our communion liturgy, we invite God to pour out the Spirit on these elements and on those of us who are gathered here. As we prepare for communion, hear those words with new ears. What does it mean for the Spirit to be poured out on these elements and us? Friends, let us discern the movement of the Spirit together as we embrace the gift of Pentecost. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Christ our Lord. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him and earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Jesus Christ. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from captivity to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of my new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us the trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." The table is prepared. We invite those who are helping serve communion to come forward. Thank you. Let us pray. Holy God, in these elements may we taste the lingering taste of your love. May we be filled with the Spirit, so as we leave from this place, we might be a sacrament of that same love to all those we encounter. Amen. Let us join together in our closing hymn, We Are the Church, verses 1 through 3 and 5. Friends, by Wednesday, you will have forgotten almost everything I've said in my sermon, but that song will be stuck in your head for the rest of your life. Let us bless one another using the benediction in your bulletin. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again through our doors. In the name of the Creator and the Christ and the Holy Spirit, go in peace. Amen.